In the Voice of Russia World Service, welcome to another edition of the Christian Message from Moscow. You're listening to an excerpt from the funeral service. The recording was made on March the 8th, 1998, at St. Daniel's Cemetery in Moscow. That day, the first Sunday of Lent, witnessed the acquisition of the holy relics of a wonderful Orthodox zealot, the Blessed Matrona Nikonova, born in 1885 and deceased in 1952.
The great Russian saint John of Kronstadt, upon discerning the 14-year-old Matrona among a crowd of pilgrims come to see him, asked everyone to step asunder and let the girl come through and approach him. As she walked towards him, he exclaimed, "Here goes my successor, the eighth pillar of Russia."
To this day, no one can explain the significance of that phrase spoken by him. However, the fact that Saint John of Kronstadt, known for his gift of spiritual foresight, singled Matrona out in the crowd and sought to converse with her, testifies to his having recognized the holy seal upon her. Today, there isn't a single Orthodox believer in Russia who has not heard of the Blessed Matronushka, as she was lovingly called, and who doesn't pray to her. She is also known to thousands of people of other confessions who turned to her in their hour of need for spiritual guidance and were granted this help. We are dedicating this edition to the Blessed Matrona of Moscow. The Blessed Matrona was born in the village of Sebina, Tula region, slightly over 300 kilometers south of Moscow, in a very poor peasant family in 1885. She was the fourth child in the family, and as such, an unwelcome extra mouth to feed. Already prior to her birth, her mother had decided to give her away to an orphanage for children of the poor. However, right before childbirth, she saw a wondrous dream. The daughter that was not yet born descended to her from the sky in the shape of a bird with a human face. Her eyes were shut. As a God-loving, devout Christian, the woman took the dream for what it was, a sign from above, and abandoned all plans of giving up her child.
The girl was born totally blind, with firmly shut eyelids and a cross-shaped protrusion on her chest. As is the custom, she was christened 40 days after birth. When the local clergyman, Vasily Troitsky, dipped her into the font, a column of light, sweet-scented steam rose up from the font to the ceiling. The clergyman was amazed and said, I have christened many an infant, but never have I seen anything like this. This infant shall be a saint.
The child was christened Matrona in honor of the Reverend Matrona, a Greek zealot of the 5th century. The Nikonov house stood facing the village church, consecrated in honor of the Dormition of the Holy Mother of God. Since the family was noted for its piety, the parents and children frequently attended church. As for Matrona, she loved church services so much, she spent most of her time there. Matrona had her own favorite spot in church, to the left from the main entrance door. She stood there with closed eyelids, rooted to the spot, and looked as though she was sleeping. Matrona knew the church chants and often sang along with the choir. It appears that already in her childhood, she was granted the gift of ceaseless prayer.
The blind Matrona had been endowed by the Lord with spiritual foresight. Already in her infancy, at night, when everyone was asleep, the girl somehow made her way into the holy corner where the icons stood, took them down from the shelf, and attempted to converse with them. Her parents were most surprised when they found their little daughter occupied in this manner for the first time.
When Matrona grew up, she suddenly began evincing the gift of spiritual vision. Thus, once her mother, who was getting ready for church, began calling her husband to go with her. For some reason, though, he refused. He was praying at home. In the meantime, mother stood in church, deeply perturbed by father's conspicuous absence at the service. Due to this, she prayed most absent-mindedly. When she returned home from church, Matrona turned to her and said, "You were not at church, Mother." "What do you mean I wasn't at church?" asked Mother in surprise. "I have just returned from church, see?" The girl, however, remarked, "Now, Father, he was in church, but you were never there." With her spiritual vision, the girl had seen that the mother was only physically attending church service, while in spirit, she was outside the church. Whenever at times the mother would turn to Matrona pityingly and say, "You poor, unfortunate child," surprised, she would respond, "I? Unfortunate? Why, I'm the happiest of people." She knew that God had granted her so much more than to other people. At the age of 7, besides the gift of spiritual vision, Matrona developed the gift of healing. This fact became widely known, and from that time on, the Nikonovs' home began to draw the ailing and afflicted from all over the region, who made their way here daily in the hopes the little girl would work a miracle for them. People begged Matrona to pray for them and cure them of their illnesses. In gratitude for the help received, visitors left the young healer's parents various gifts and food packages. Thus, the blind and poorly Matrona did not become a burden for her parents, as they had feared, but in fact was the family's main breadwinner.
Residents of Matrona's native village of Sibina address her for help and guidance to this day. Listen to what one of the village women says.
"She helps us. Indeed she does," says the woman. "My daughter suffered tremendously from a pain in her arm, and I said to her, 'Valya, rub your hand with this oil.' I had taken the oil from the icon lamp that glowed before the icon of the blessed Matrona. She rubbed on the oil, and the pain disappeared. And once my cow stopped giving any milk, not a gram, So I put some of that icon lamp oil onto her udder, and now she gives plenty of milk. Well, what can I say? My own grandmother used to go to Matrona for help. She knew her well when she was alive. It's interesting how, although she was blind, Matrona always recognized who exactly had come to visit her, calling them by name, whether she was acquainted with them or not.
At the age of 17, Matrona suddenly lost the use of her legs. From that moment on, and to the end of her days, she was unable to walk. However, she never complained of her fate, meekly accepting this heavy burden from God.
Two icons of the Mother of God, called the icon of Our Lady in Search of the Perishing, are linked with the name of the Blessed Matrona. One was written for the church in her native village. This is how it was. Once Matrona said to her mother, "Mother, I keep dreaming of the icon of Our Lady in Search of the Perishing." The Mother of God asks to be admitted to our church. And then the girl instructed her mother to tell the local clergyman that in his library he had a book with a picture of the above-mentioned icon. The girl even mentioned on which shelf he would find the book he needed. When the book with a picture of the icon was found, Matrona asked the clergyman for his blessing, so that she might commission an icon painter to make a copy of this icon for their church. After she received his blessing, Matrona turned to the believers of her village with a request to collect the needed money to pay the icon painter. The money was promptly collected, and the icon was commissioned from a painter in the town of Bogorodetsk, Tula region. When the icon was ready, the folk from Matrona's village carried it in a cross-bearing procession all the way from Bogorodetsk to the church in their native Sibina. With people leading her, Matrona set out to welcome the icon. At some point, she addressed those leading her with the words, "Stop. Do not go any further. They are already close. They shall come and bring the icon in half an hour." Indeed, 30 minutes later, the cross-bearing procession appeared. They guided Matrona up to the icon. She placed her hand on the corner of the icon and held on to it thus until the procession reached Sibina. This icon became the main local holy relic, and it was famed for its miracles. When drought struck, they used to bring it out onto the meadow in the village center and hold a prayer service. After this, people hardly had time to reach their homes when it began to rain. The other icon of Our Lady in Search of the Perishing was commissioned by Matrona for herself. After selecting an icon painter, Matrona asked him if he would be able to paint the icon she wanted. He answered that this was all in the line of work for him. However, once he started, things didn't go so well. As to why, the nun Antonina from the Convent of the Holy Intercession of the Mother of God in Moscow, where Matrona's sacred relics lie, explains. He couldn't paint the icon straight away because there was a sin he hadn't repented of yet, says Sister Antonina. Matrona could see this sin with her spiritual vision. So she said to the painter, "You killed a man and did not confess and repent your sin. Go forth and confess." The icon painter did as told, and only then was he able to paint the icon. It turned out wonderful. It is now in the church where the relics of the Blessed Matrona lie. You are welcome to come to this icon.
Let me add that many have received help from praying to this icon. As a testimony of this, they have left as tributes to the Holy Mother of God gold and silver ornaments that can be seen today on chainlets attached to the icon.
When still a teenager, Matrona predicted the revolution in Russia. She described in detail how churches would be desecrated and plundered, how believers would be persecuted, and what a bloody struggle would unfold for the land. On the eve of the revolution, Matrona advised the local landowner, Yinkov, whose family was charitable towards the Nikonovs, to sell his estate and go abroad. If he had listened to her, he wouldn't have witnessed the pillaging of his estate and would have escaped death, while his daughter would not have become destitute.
Matrona herself was forced to lead a vagarious life in Soviet years. In 1925, at the age of 40, she was forced to leave her native village because of her two brothers, Mikhail and Ivan, both staunch communists and, as such, atheists. The two were irritated by the ceaseless procession of needy and ailing folk coming to their homestead because of Matrona. Besides, bearing in mind the persecutions that revolutionary authorities subjected Orthodox Christians to, the brothers feared for their own lives and the lives of their family and kin. For this reason, Matrona, with the help of friends, found herself in Moscow, where she had relatives and acquaintances. She was forced to move from one lodging to another, avoiding confrontation with the atheist authorities. The Lord kept watch over her. She always knew in advance when they were coming to arrest her, and so she was able to move on and avoid arrest. Her friends always managed to take her to some safe place in the nick of time. Matrona's life followed pretty much the same as always. In the daytime, she received visitors, and at night, she prayed. In this manner, the years passed.
Living in Moscow, the Blessed Matrona spent the longest stretch of time staying in the home of Zinaida Zhdanova, whose mother came from the same village as Matrona. In this connection, let's make a brief digression into the pre-revolutionary past. Zinaida Zhdanova recalls that her mother Yevdokia was never attractive, and in her home village of Sebina was commonly regarded as an unpromising old maid. However, Matrona insisted that Yevdokia's husband would be a handsome gentleman sporting a moustache. None of the villagers believed her.
In the meantime, Matrona advised Yevdokia to go to Moscow and seek employment there. Yevdokia took her advice, and after lengthy wanderings about Moscow, finally landed the job of a cook in the wealthy Zhdanov household. These gentlefolk resided in the heart of Moscow, in an aristocratic area abut. The hostess had an only son, a very handsome and dignified man, whose bride was the Duchess Ksenia Shuhova. Once, at night, he heard the saver's voice say to him, "Vladimir, marry Yevdokia." Shaken by what had happened, the following morning he asked his mother if there was a Yevdokia working in their employ. "Yes, indeed," replied his mother. "She is our cook." Next, listen to the recollections of Vladimir Zhdanov's daughter, Zinaida.
"Father went into the kitchen, and upon seeing Yevdokia, almost fainted. He felt so sorry for himself. Soon afterwards, father, who was studying at the Institute of Transport, left for practical studies in the town of Perm in the Urals. He drove in his own carriage with a coachman. Part of the way lay through a dense wood. Suddenly, a gnarled old man with a bundle on his back came towards them out of the wood. He wore white linen robe tied with a rope. Father said to the coachman, 'Turn off the road, let the old man pass.' The coachman did as told, but the elder stopped and said to my father, 'Vladimir, marry Yevdokia,' and disappeared. Upon arriving back in Moscow, father saw an icon of the Reverend Saint Seraphim of Sarov in one of the churches, and immediately recognized the elder that he and his coachman had encountered. In 1915, father was to go off on practice again, this time for a whole year. Mother sent the cook Yevdokia with him. sure that the ungainly employee would not be any temptation for him. However, Father, a sincerely religious man, ever respectful of the Lord's will, nonetheless married the plain Evdokia, just as the Lord had instructed him. This was 2 years before the revolution, while in the year of the revolution, in 1917, I was born. Father settled Mother and I in a two-story house, right in front of the Holy Trinity St. Sergius Monastery, in Sergiev Posad, a town which stands outside Moscow. He frequently visited us there. Father was obliged to live separately from us, since his parents never did accept the fact that a gentleman had married a cook, and refused to acknowledge Mother and myself. However, this marriage to a commoner saved Father and many of his relatives, who were close to the emperor, from execution by the Bolsheviks. Nonetheless, Father himself did not manage to avoid arrest and detention camps. They arrested him in the autumn of 1941 in Moscow, in the house of his late parents, where we were living at the time, in the midst of World War II. For a long time, we got no word of his whereabouts. However, Matronushka, who was living with us, said, "He is alive. He'll be back. And on the eve you shall receive a letter from him. He will write to tell you where he is and ask you to save his books." 6 years later, we got just such a letter from Father. It contained a postscript from the doctor, saying that Father was emaciated and on his deathbed. We found a woman who had an opportunity to clandestinely send Father our parcel containing food. We constantly prayed for his survival. And finally, Father came back to us. He died already in peaceful time from cancer. At the time we had living with us, besides the blessed Matrona, an elder by the name of Mitrofani, whom Matrona loved greatly. She used to say, "When I am gone, you shall have him for support." One morning, the blessed Mitrofani approached Father's bedside and said to him, "Vladimir, you know, tonight I saw your death. Do not fear it. It is very tall and very terrifying, but to you it shall be very merciful." Father grabbed his hand and kissed it. On the third day after this, I came into Father's room in the morning and felt a scent I had never known before, while a strange joy and anticipation gripped my being. Before I could realize what this was, Father said to me, "Zina, I shall be dying in a moment. Do not interfere." I loved my father very much, but for some reason I wasn't in the least upset by his pronouncement. While Mother lit an icon lamp before the icon next to Dad's sofa and started reading the Psalter, I got Father's burial clothes ready and showed them to him. Then, for some reason, I rushed to the kitchen. When I returned, I noticed Father was looking intently to the right. "Father, can you see someone there?" I asked. "Yes," he replied. "In a moment they shall smite off my legs." At that point, Father's legs, which had been bent at the knees, collapsed. "And now they shall smite off my arms," continued Father. "And now come and hold up my head. They shall smite it off next." Thus holding Father's head, I felt something like a moist knot of wool come out of his mouth. His head grew cold. Coming to my senses, I shouted, "Father, look at me one last time." And he turned his fast fading glance towards me. In the meantime, the room became filled with a sweet aroma. Mother and I felt joy, and no tears fell from our eyes. That was how blissful my father's death was. Many years later, the blessed elder Mitrofani told me, "You know, I have seen your father. He is in heaven and told me, it isn't at all terrifying to die. I also dreamt of Father, and in the dream he said to me, Zina, the Lord has forgiven me all my sins. From then on, I no longer feared death. As it turns out, for God-fearing, devout Christians, it can be both swift and joyous.
Tune in to hear continuation of the narrative about the Reverend Matrona, a Moscow saint, and the people she helped in our following program, same time next week.
And there we end another edition of the Christian Message from Moscow. It was directed by Vladimir Dyomin, author and music editor Tatiana Shvitsova, sound engineer Yelena Gashennikova, and your hosts Svetlana Yakimenko
and Pavel Novichkov. All the best to you.
And may God save you from all evil, visible and invisible.